everybody, welcome back to Saturday night edition of Gordy's Gas Bags. It's because I have nothing to do with my life that I thought, why don't we just roll on Kiwi Week into the weekend? And that's what we did. Now, you were all sitting around all week crying your eyes out because I hadn't come to find this person. Well, courtesy of LL Cool J last night, she said, go hunt down IVD, and that is what I've done. She was without a doubt I think the best face of netball, the most well-known face of netball across the world. Ladies and gentlemen, on episode 23, courtesy of Corona, please welcome Irene van Dijk. Yay! Crowd goes crazy. Hey.
They go nuts.
Yeah, they go nuts.
Good
morning.
How are you? Good. How are you?
You look sensational.
Oh, thanks. It must be the sun in Hawke's Bay.
Yeah. Do you know, on your New Zealand Silver Fern bio, the first word says ageless.
Oh, wow. Wow. Who wrote that?
How nice of them.
Yeah, I know. God.
I think they don't know. Like that. Yeah, you were a bit, I think it's a really good word.
Do you reckon?
Yeah.
I don't feel it. Did you see the other day? So I'm doing all these little videos for the Future Ferns that I'm involved with. And the other day I did a video, chucked the ball up in the air, tried to get off the ground and catch the ball before the ball landed. I ended up bumming the rose bush. It was not a pretty sight. So ageless, I'm not quite sure because this body does not bend the same way it did 20 years ago.
Hey, you do love the sun, don't you? That's something you and I share two really good things in common. Do you know what they both are?
A beer and sun.
We love a Corona, don't we?
We totally do.
Oh, that's so funny. A beer in the sun. So you were just saying that the weather's good over there at the moment?
Oh, it's absolutely fabulous. In Hawke's Bay, it is just stunning. So we'll get the temperature drops quite significantly when the sun goes down, but then the days you get up to 20 degrees. So it's beautiful.
Yeah, nice.
And I'm out on the bike or go for a walk with a dog or do whatever I do. As long as the sun shines, it just fills my cup with gratitude. I'm just, it's happiness.
Yeah, vitamin D is our best friend.
Oh, hell yes.
Yeah, I agree. Hey, I've been asking your Kiwi counterparts for the best part of the week how COVID's going for you.
It's quite hard. So there's some of very close friends of mine that's lost their jobs or they've cut down on hours to try and make ends meet and those kind of things. So it's kind of a mixed bag. So we have dropped down hours as well. I'm just thankful that I still have a job and I still get to do what I love doing. So it is quite hard for some, I'm a very empathetic kind of person and it feels like it hits me as hard as it hits someone else. So yes, it's kind of a mixed bag of emotion. Mm. I think New Zealand, I think Jacinda Ardern is epic. I think she is a leader from NAM and I think she's doing an incredible job. If us as Kiwis just stick to what is planned and get out of level three, our numbers are going down today, it's slightly up again, but we're heading in the right direction. And I think if we just follow the rules, we'll be out of here in no time.
Tell us what you are doing now. So a lot of people are really interested to know what the great Irene van Dijk is up to post netball career. And we spoke with Yvonne Willering the other night and she says she loves watching where you're at and what you're doing. So talk us through your current life.
So I am lucky enough to still be involved with netball. It's in your blood. I work for Netball Central Zone, which covers pretty much the lower North Island.
Yep.
And I present workshops to parents who want to become coaches who just has no confidence or want to get involved and start to coach their little kids but don't have any resources. So I do workshops for them, and when they walk out of my workshop they feel 10-foot-tall, bulletproof, and they can take on the world.
Hey, do they? So this is a good one. Do they know who you are? Like, do these parents? Because theoretically, they're parents that are just kind of going like, I don't know a great deal about netball. Maybe do they kind of come in and go, oh yeah, who are you? Or is it like, oh my goodness, it's you?
No, the parents are epic. The parents know exactly who I am. And then the little kids will come and the parents are like, take a photo with her. And the kids are like, are you crazy? What the hell? Why? Why? She's old. And the parents are like, you want to take a photo with her? So the parents are really lovely. They know who I am, but the kids have no idea because it's all the 5, 6, 7, 8, 19-year-olds. So they've well and truly missed my boat.
Yeah, they're more interested in Amelia and Echinacea now.
Oh, aren't we all? Yes. Gorgeous.
Hey, how good was she in the final? Or the final? Oh,
just incredible. You know, that whole game was just phenomenal. And the way that they played, as soon as they had the English team against the Aussies in that round robin game, I was like, holy moly. But it just shows you what a genius Nolene Toto is. Because in the way she played that round robin game and the way she played the final is two completely different games. It was just phenomenal to watch. As soon as she started with those changes, I was like, oh God, I'm starting to hyperventilate. I was like, I don't know if this is going to work for us. But, you know, you just have to believe the process. That lady is, she's genius.
Well, I was going to say, I'm surprised you were hyperventilating because you should know Nolene. You know what she's like. You know that her brain goes at 100 miles an hour and it can't quite keep up with what's coming out of her mouth and whatnot. I actually remember in ANZ Champs days, and it was the year that you guys won.
2012.
And I recall interviewing you at the time, and I remember asking you a question around what is it about Nolene? What is it about Nolene? And you couldn't answer. You were just like, I just remember you kind of go, I can't even explain. Can you explain now?
I think it's her unpredictability and the fact that she is so in tune with her players, the surrounding, the opposition. Every little thing that could potentially have an influence on the game, she is so in tune to anything.
Yeah.
And she coaches with her gut. If it feels right, she's going to make a change. If it doesn't feel right, she's going to let it go. And yeah, I think too, knowing your players so well. And look, I've played for her for 11 years. I would, you know, if she tell me to take a bullet, I'll take a bullet. For that lady, I'll take a bullet. So, you know, it's one of those people that you would literally, she makes you play for yourself, for your family, for the country. And, you know, it's always bigger than you. It's not about you. It's always bigger than you.
Are you then telling me that by no means were you surprised when Casey's phone rang and said, come back, and Laura was back on the scene? Is that how powerful this lady is?
Oh, hell yeah. I would have come out of retirement at the Sharks.
Not really. I was just kind of leading you into it.
I'll tell you what, there'll be a few people with bazookas ready if I do that.
Oh, that's funny. But she is. Even in chatting with Laura along the way, and I guess that, you know, the when you hear players interviewed, it's about, I guess it is about shaping a sense of Nolene. And I feel like the reason Australians have had such an interest in her is because she's been in our backyard for 3 years, or she was in our backyard for 3 years leading up to this. And, you know, on Monday night when we spoke to her, she paid an absolute tribute to what Australia has done for her. And it's just, I think it's really interesting. It's amazing how, can I ask you the question I asked her? Do you look at, say, that last Constellation Cup and go, oh yeah, the rivalry's back?
Oh yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. It is, and it's really exciting. I think for our sport, we need it. Mm. And I think, you know, the Australian young ones coming through, they are going to be strong. But if you look at the silver ferns and the young ones coming through at the moment during ANZ, they are just as strong. So I think we've got a few years of some doozies coming up.
Yeah. Hey, who's in the background stirring their tea? Cup of tea.
Oh, it's Bianca.
Bianca, come and say hello. B, where are you?
Bianca, just wave.
Hi, Bianca. How are you coping?
I've got my earphones in, so she can't hear you.
She can't hear. ask her how she's coping being at home.
How are you coping being at home?
It's good.
It's good. She has to say that because I'm sitting away.
you two are best of mates, aren't you?
Oh, God, yeah. Yeah, she is. I love watching her, and I love having her home. She just ran 4 half marathons in 4 weeks. I'm like...
Really?
Who does that? She's insane. She really? Is so... Oh, just loves it. Just loves the outdoors, loves going for a run. Oh, it's awesome to watch. It is so cool to watch.
What's her future? What's she going to go on and do?
Well, she is playing club netball for me for the first time. So when she grew up and when she went through school, I didn't want to touch her because I know, you know, New Zealand's quite small and people get quite upset when things, you know, the whole, I don't know, politics around netball, but she was never going to get away with it because we look so similar.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to coach her because I didn't want to seem to, you know, favour her or do things like that. So I never touched her. And when she came back from the Gold Coast last year, I was like, are you going to play netball? And she was like, I'd love to play netball. So, yes, we moved to Napier mid last year. And being new here, I had to obviously make myself available to become a coach. So I'm coaching Hastings High School old girls. And Bianca was like, I'll come and play for you. So we went through the whole trial thing. And it is just, it's so nice because now I can tell her what I want her to do.
And she listens?
Yeah, really good. Yeah. Really, she likes the hard stuff. Just give it to her the way it is. Don't try and sugarcoat it. Yeah. Just say that movement was not good. What were you thinking? She likes it. Just give it to her.
Is that the same as the way you liked to be coached?
Oh, yes. Yes. As a player, if I did something, I wanted the coach to go, what were you thinking? Were you thinking at that point in time? And then just tell me what I've done wrong or tell me how I can do it better. Because sometimes you do it and you're like, oh, God, what happened there? And luckily, though, we had all the video analysis and we had all those kind of things that we could have used. Whereas earlier years, Auntie Nels just said, do this, do that. You're like, okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
If you don't mind, I want to, because Gordy's Gas Bags is about having a bit of a gas bag about yesteryear, I do need to take you back. I want to go back pre the headband and eyeliner moment. Right.
Hey, I couldn't play for shit, but I looked pretty good. I looked pretty damn good.
that photo is quite iconic. Whenever you Google Irene Van Dyke, and it comes up front and center every time.
Need to find that kind of makeup that does not run when you sweat or do anything like that. I have never come across anything like that. I should get
people,
some.
Please write in and let Irene know where you get your non-run eyeliner from.
That stick there like glue for like Perfect. 2 weeks.
South Africa, did you grow up playing netball? Was that like the sport of choice?
Yes. So I grew up on a farm and I went to a little farm school. Loved everything about school. And I can remember one of my friends started playing netball and she was like, you need to come play because we've got 6 in our age group and we need one more girl so we can make 7. And started playing netball, loved it, wasn't any good at all, didn't play any rep netball until I turned 18. So,
what position did you play early?
Goal attack, goal shoot.
Okay.
Yeah, because I admired my sister, and she was a goal attack. She was amazing. And you know what? On the farm, she had a goal post, so she would take shots, and she'd make me the rebounder. And she was like, the rebounder is such an important job. So she's 10 years older than me. She's like, it's really important when the ball comes through that you turn and you pass it back to me. So you catch it when it comes through. And it wasn't until probably 20 years ago that I realized she just used me. She didn't want to go for the rebound. She just wanted me to pass the ball back to her. But she made me feel like I was the most important person in her life at that point in time. Loved it. So, yes. So that was pretty much, in South Africa growing up, you had a winter sport and a summer sport. And summer I did athletics, and in winter I played netball. So that was pretty much the two sports that I did.
And, I mean, I don't want to go through your story because so many, I mean, it's been so, you were the most documented netballer of your time, let's be blatantly honest. So
I'm an open book.
You are an open book. What about writing a book?
Oh, wow. There was one written by Russell Gray when I just immigrated to New Zealand. Wow, there'll be a lot of information going into this second one.
Well, we'll get to a little bit of it in just a minute. Let's just recap, though, because you played, 72 tests for South Africa?
South Africa, yeah.
Yeah, so a special time because obviously it was your debut. I mean, you had two debuts, so to speak, but this was your true blue debut playing international netball.
It was amazing. Gordy, I was lucky enough to be in the first team that could represent South Africa out of isolation. So after 28 years of isolation and sanctions and everything against South Africa, I was in the first team that actually went over to the UK and represented my country, and it was just incredible. We played 8 tests, I can remember, 5 against England, 1 against Northern Ireland, Wales, and Scotland. And we won all eight the tests.
Wow.
It was just incredible. I thought Afrikaans was an international language. Hello. No, it's not, Irene. We had our captain, Debbie Harman. She is bilingual, so she's just phenomenal. And she had to sit in all my interviews and be my interpreter.
Oh, wow.
Yes. Yeah.
So not many spoke bilingual? No, not many were bilingual?
And that first team that went over? No. There were probably about 3 or 4 of them that was completely bilingual. The rest of us, you know the vocabulary, but to string words together and to answer someone's questions, hell, that was hard.
Yeah. What was it like living over in South Africa through all of that time there in that early...
You know, growing up, you don't ask questions. It's just the way life is. So you know, we lived on a farm. We were lucky enough that our farm workers were through the generations. They came through the generations the way our farm went through the generations. So it kind of was like family that you had. And the only friends I knew of were the ones that grew up on the farm. So, and they were black. So I never asked questions. And in the morning, they would go to their school. I would go to my school. It was no questions asked. And it wasn't until probably when I went to study that they all of a sudden opened the hostels for black people and white people. And there were massive rouses because people weren't happy with it. And, you know, you're like, that was the first time it hit me right between the eyeballs, like, oh, my God. Because politics was never talked about in our family, like in our household or anything. So it was, you just grew up with whatever's happening. And it wasn't until I went studying that I was like, oh my God, how weird. Mm. So we had a few black people in our hostel, which was fine because, well, you grow up with them, so it's okay. But yeah, it was just... I couldn't believe that I was so in isolation that I never actually saw or questioned anything.
Yeah.
And then it was just, it was just normal after that, because Nelson Mandela became president, and you know, everyone admired him. Everyone thought he was bigger than Ben Hur, and he just did so much for the country, and it was perfect. Transition was perfect.
Everyone says that their upbringing, you know, shapes them in some way. How much did that upbringing shape you?
It clearly didn't shape me at all, because I'm not racist in any shape or form. Like I played with black little kids because they were the only ones on the farm. So it was never a black and a white thing, you know. So it was weird that I didn't actually ask the question, or it wasn't brought up until I went and studied. And then it was, like I said, the transition was so easy, because after that, you know, we had the quota system where we had to have black players in our team. And it was literally just, you just do as you're told, and you don't question, because it is just the way it is. And luckily enough, we had some incredible players that could play netball and who were there on merit, not by colour, but by merit.
I was going to delve in, and you've probably answered it, but just with that quota system, I recall a game that South Africa played over in Perth. I was at that game, and I just remember I was aware of the quota system. In my head, I struggled to understand how a team could be selected like that. I couldn't grasp it, because I wasn't a part of a system that involved. But I remember watching some of the black players go on the court, and I was mesmerised how good they were, and their speed and their flair and their, you know, and I just thought, oh, gee, imagine this future when quotas don't exist.
Exactly. And we had Rosie, who was as tall as me, Munchell. Mm. We had Ruski. We had, oh, my God, we had incredible players, and we were in awe of them, and it was just unfortunate that they've never been seen.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
What a difference.
So it was. Yeah. Oh, and if you look at them now, they're just phenomenal athletes. Mm. They're just true athletes. The ability, the natural ability, is just fabulous to watch.
You met Christy over there?
In South Africa, yes. We studied teaching together.
Yep. Married there?
Yes. Yes, we celebrated our 25th wedding anniversary last year. So
there you go. Ageless.
I know. He wouldn't say the same. He'd be like, "Oh my God, it's hard work."
who was out of the two of you? Who had the conversation first about let's move?
Me. Because in 1999, I was approached by Kathy Doyle, who was the president of Netball Wellington at that point in time. And she said to me, would you like to come over to Wellington for 6 months to play in the Coca-Cola Cup? And Mum was at in Christchurch for the World Champs. And I said to Mum, wow, this lady came up to me and asked if I should do it. And Mum was like, oh, you'll be crazy not to. That'd be an incredible experience. And you know when your mother tells you something is right, you know something is right.
Yeah.
You do it. So, yes, that was the start of it. And then Christy stayed in South Africa because he had to teach. And we came over for 6 months. And then in April, Mum said to me, because Mum came over with Bianca. So it was Mum, Bianca and I. And in April, Mum said to me, I can't see you going back to South Africa, because, you know, we lived in a place, you didn't even have to lock the doors. You go out, Bianca can ride a bike, go ride a scooter, go as far as she can, you know, next to the river. It's really safe. Things we did here that we'd never, ever thought of doing in South Africa. Mm. And I rang Christy and I said to him, come over for a holiday. He was like, you're not coming back, are you?
Oh.
I was like, come on, I'll come back if I have to, but just come over. And he loved it. And it was pretty much, he went back, packed everything up, and emigrated. In July, end of July, he arrived in New Zealand.
Wow, what a time. And then you delve into becoming a silver fern. I think the story goes, am I right? It wasn't that great to begin with, was it?
Oh, no, it was not ideal. The majority of the people were lovely. Some of the media, not so much. I can remember Tony Beach. He ripped into me. He was like, do you realize you are taking a silver fern's place who's been training all her life? Do you realize it is a Kiwi that has lived here, that this was her dream all her life? You come from another country, you waltz into the team, and you're taking someone's space. And I was like, honestly, it was not a good interview. But I think the media started changing once they realized we were here as a lifestyle change. And it wasn't going to be a hit and run. I wasn't going to come play and go. It was definitely, we were immigrating. We were going to stay in New Zealand. This will be our home.
Mm. Your debut game with the Silver Ferns over in Australia, Timipara, we spoke about the other night. You and Bubby debut on the same game. Not a good
one. Oh, my God. Oh. Did she have a good memory of it?
Oh, yeah, she did. She had a better memory of 4 years earlier not getting on the court and going shopping with Teabag, but she said, yeah, she said it did drive her from that point on. She said that was unacceptable.
Yeah, it was unbelievable because so I was lucky enough not to have stood down. You know, after I immigrated, they pretty much changed the rules and people had to stand down for a calendar year. Hey, yep. Like from 4 years.
4 years.
Yeah. Yep. And so I was lucky enough to be able to play for the Ferns straight away. And my first training, I was in such awe of all these bloody Silver Ferns. I'll tell you what.
Who was there that you were just like crazy?
Oh, Donna, Belinda, Annie, Julie Seymour, Bernice Minnie, Linda Wagner. Just like,
wow.
It's all the people that I played against in World Champs. In Christchurch, and I sat there, looked at them and go, oh my God, they're so fast, they're so good, they jump so high, they just do everything so amazingly. And that first training, I can remember Yvonne put me as goal shooter and Julie Seymour was centre, Anna Robbery wing attack, and Donna goal attack, mm-hmm. wing attack, Donna goal attack. And that ball came down so quickly that I haven't even had time to move. And Julie was standing on the top of the circle. She was like, Irene, are you going to move? I was like, oh, yeah, you just came a bit fast. I was like, oh, my God, that was so fast. And I could see on the side of my eye that Yvonne was just like, what have I done? So Yvonne pulled me off and Bill played with Donna.
Yeah.
And Yvonne said, come stand here. So I stood next to Yvonne and she was like, what do you see? I was like, oh my God, they're so fast. Wow, that's just incredible. And then the ball flung through and I was like, oh my God, that's amazing. And Yvonne was like, shush, just zip it. I do not need running commentary.
Right here.
And I was just like, have you seen how fast they are? I was like, did you actually witness that? She was like, Irene, shush. And then we went over to Oz. And that first test, it was definitely a highlight, make no mistake. Even if we got absolutely slaughtered, it was a highlight. And I can remember I wasn't in the starting line. Thank goodness I wasn't. And then all of them started and I was like all excited to be there. And Yvonne looked at some point, she looked at me and she was like, go warm up. And I looked at the rest of the team and I was like, go warm up. And I was quite happy sitting because I was like, there's no bloody way I'm getting out there. Oh, hell no. And then I felt someone next to me and she was like, go warm up. I was like, are you sure? Like, is this a good decision? Like, is this a really good decision? She's go. I was like, oh God. And the whole time I was like, I don't know how I'm going to cope with this. I don't know how I'm going to cope with this. So that was, oh, it was just unbelievable. It was a learning, that whole first year was a learning curve, because all of a sudden I had to go to a gym. I've never been to a gym in my whole freaking life.
Yeah.
Who does that? Who pumps iron when you play netball? Seriously. And then you had a fitness program. Jeez, you run a lot. All these things that happen, and I'm like, flip, where have I been?
Yeah.
Not part of my game, but yeah.
Massive eye opener. How were you treated? So, you know, we talk about how the media treated you. What were those players like towards you? Because I would imagine for someone like Donna or for Belinda Colling, that they're like, hold on a second, you know, because I could be, how did they treat you?
No, they were amazing. Honestly, they were fantastic. Right from the word go. I don't know behind my back if there was a little bit of animosity, but in front of me, they were just amazing. And they all made me feel so welcome. And I think that's the thing with Kiwis. You know, like, we do make one another feel so welcome and so, just part of something bigger. So, yeah, no, I loved everyone. Right from the first word. And right from Julie Seymour teaching me the national anthem. Yeah. God, that was the scariest time of my life. You know, she flicked me like two words and I need to say what's coming after that. And I'm like, duh. So it was a learning experience, but I wouldn't change it for the world. Had the best players around me those first few years.
Do you remember at what point, and I know that you say that your debut game would have been, you know, it was glorious and all that. But at what point do you remember standing, representing New Zealand and going, I'm a Kiwi? Because I don't...
Right from
the... Really, from the very first game.
So I was, again, lucky enough that when we immigrated here, we played in South Africa in after we played the tests. Against yep. Aussie, we yep. travelled to South Africa.
Right.
And when I stood there against the country that I've grown up with and played for, that singing that anthem right there, it was incredibly emotional. I can remember Yvonne pulling me closer because I struggled. It was really hard because my family was standing there cheering on the South Africans, and all of a sudden I am a Kiwi.
Mm.
And I think at that point in time, and I think because I made up my mind that this is going to be my home, as soon as I went through that anthem, I was like, it's game on. Now this is it. I've made up my mind.
How were you received by the South Africans?
Amazing. Yeah, South Africans don't hold grudges. You know, like I think everyone knew why I've made the move and the opportunities that I was getting here in New Zealand. And there was no way that I would have had the same opportunities going back to South Africa. And in saying that too, like Chrissy and I, job wise, we were both teachers in South Africa. We had teaching jobs 3 months at a time. So every 3 months, when those 3 months are up, you're like, oh God, am I going to have a job next for the next 3 months? So that uncertainty wasn't a good one either. Whereas when I came to New Zealand and I applied to become a teacher and all my paperwork was looked after and everything was fine, I got a job and it was a permanent job. And Christy applied for a job and it was a permanent job. And it wasn't that 3 month anxiousness of, are we going to have a job or not? So, there's just so many things that fell into place that it was meant to be.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And, best decision we've made, because honestly, this country is phenomenal.
Yeah, and I can tell how much you love it. I understand completely. Do you think you were the sort of person coming through that right, not from the get-go, or maybe from the get-go, said, I'm going to be the best in the world at what I do.
Oh, no, not at all. I actually thought I was going to be a hurdler.
Oh, see, because okay.
I was this thin when I grew up, and I was really good at hurdles up until my last year of school. And then I went and studied. And you know, that first year of study, just when you're away from home, you start drinking, you start eating pies and hot dogs and footlongs and bus. your nutrition goes right out the window. Yeah. So I think I gained about 20 kgs in my first year of study.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh God, I'm too slow to hurdle at this point in time. So I'll just go hang out at the netball courts.
and you're gone.
And to be quite honest, between my ages of 16 and 18, I grew 20 centimeters.
Wow.
Honestly, I looked like this freak coming down the street because my bones and my muscles didn't quite marry up. Oh my, it was just weird. And I think my mum would have thought, what's happening to my child? Is she ever going to stop? Because I was a big bird. I know. No, I am a big bird. God damn it. Yeah.
So back then, like, you know, and in our game, yeah. you were big.
Yeah, yeah. The biggest bitch in town.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I think that's what Liz Ellis used to say, the biggest bitch in town.
Yeah. So, no, it was, I never thought I'd be a netballer. Mm. And, yeah, I just... Because I was never selected for any rep tournaments either. Always went to play trials, but was never selected until my last year of school. And again, I think I was selected because I grew so much in that last year of school. So, yeah, I was just really lucky that I got these opportunities and people saw me at the right time being at the right place. So, yeah, it kind of just happened.
When did the transformation then take place in you? At what stage after you're wearing a Silver Ferns dress do you realise, I'm going to turn myself into a machine here? Because you did. I recall a moment, I think you had a new, I think the Silver Ferns got a new strength and conditioning coach. And in the off-season, well, we saw you and then off-season, I can't remember what year this was, but you came back and everyone was like, holy hell, have a look at you. Or was it?
Yeah, there was a time where I lived in Wellington and I still played in Hamilton for Waikato Bay of Plenty, and so I didn't have a fitness trainer in Wellington or that was linked to high performance sport or with Waikato Bay of Plenty. So they invested in Hugh Biz, who literally it was. He had a studio in Silver Stream, which is about 20 minutes drive from me. And I just had one-on-one time with this fitness trainer, Hugh Biz. And I still think he is the most amazing fitness trainer in the world because he literally transformed me completely. Mm-hmm. He taught me how to, if people fall on me, to land so I don't get injured. He made life so hard, but everything was planned. It was meticulous and my form had to be perfect.
Did you always have an eye for the goalpost? Because some shooters have to really develop it. There's a saying that shooters are natural, right? So that if you have to spend too much time trying to teach someone to shoot, send them to the defense end, you know. But were you natural at the post?
Yeah, I think because I grew up too with a goalpost in my backyard, when I had nothing to do, which was quite often, then I'd just go to the goalpost and play around and fool around with there. And I was one of those players that never overthink things. You know, like I spoke to Belinda Colling a few times and she would have played the game like 3 times before we actually played the game. So she must have been exhausted by the time we play games. And I'd literally switch in during the anthem. I'd be like, yeah, I do my game plan and I do my prep and all those kind of things, but I don't overthink things.
Yeah.
And yeah, I think I was one of the luckiest people that I've been surrounded with phenomenal athletes. Mm. Like to me, the people around you make the goal shooter. I'm not that good. I wasn't that good. I had players like Belinda Colling, Jodie Brown, Maria Tutaia. I had phenomenal players around me that made me look good, that made me who I was. So, yeah, it's not down to me. It was definitely the people around me that made me.
Do you think that you are, and I'm not say were, because you still are, do you think that you are so loved because you're just such a beautiful person? Like, you just, I mean, the way that you just answered that question, and I know, you know, like, you're exceptionally humble, and I've always known that of you, but, I mean, you just have such a beautiful soul, Irene, and people just gravitate to you.
I think because I've been given the opportunity to come and live in this country, I think the least I can do is give a little bit back. And, you know, sometimes people ask me when I get stopped, do I get tired of it? And I'm like, no, because, you know, it is 2 seconds of my time. But for that person, it could potentially be a lifelong memory. And it is those kind of things that I think makes me, because I thrive on seeing people smile. And, you know, if I can lend a little hand and make it a better place, then why not?
Mm. I love it. I love it about you. Hey, I have to ask you, I don't want to, you know, it's a sun, you know, like, we all have to have our time off on the weekend. But I want to ask you about, obviously, what people talk about as one of the greatest rivalries in our game, in its history, and that is you and Liz Ellis.
Oh, without a doubt.
You know, you and the two of you are good mates. You know, you're very respectful of each other. Just tell me a little bit about, you know, like, meeting Liz Ellis on a netball court.
So my first image of Liz Ellis was when I saw her first up. I was like, God, she's skinny and little for a defender. I was like, yeah, she's not going to have firepower.
Yeah.
Hello, next minute I got smacked down hard by this bird. It's like, wow. With Liz, it is not how big she is. It is how big her fight is, how big her heart is. And I think she was one of those players who nothing I did was ever good enough. Because she's got my number. She ticked those boxes day in and day out. And every time I played against her, there were things that she made me do that I didn't want to do. So she would push me on the baseline. What use am I to my teammate on a baseline? Nothing. So what am I going to do to get over that? So she was the one that when I went out there, I was like, okay, so if I stand here, where's Liz going to stand? What is she going to do to me? So every time I trained or did something, it was like, what was she going to do to me that's going to push me out of my comfort zone? And I think because both of us were in the prime of our netball careers, so you can adapt and you can try things. You don't know if it's going to come down in the game, but that is the beauty of it. Like, you know, you've practiced it, you know, you're nailing it. Is she going to make you doubt yourself? Is she going to make you fly? And I think that is the thing that I appreciate most. And I think that is why we have so much respect for one another, because she was the driving force behind me become wanting to be better than her, because she was the best in the business. So if you want to be the best in the business, you better work harder than the best in the business. And yeah, I knew she was working bloody hard, so I was like, I'm coming for you.
It is extraordinary to hear you talk about that, because that is it's almost word perfect of what Liz says in reverse of you, as in, you know, that you made her be the player she was.
That's I think because like I said, we were in the prime of our time and we could change what is happening in our end. So with her and Kath Harvey-Williams, bloody hell, they were a strong combination. So they think, or their thinking process was, we can change this. And then whoever I played with, Bill, who was a playmaker, she was like, we've got this. We just this is what we're going to do. And I think that is how, and I think during those times, there was nothing between the Ferns and the Diamonds, you know, like the one or two goals. It's like, who is not going to throw that one ball away that's going to matter? And I think that's why people remember those rivalries, because, man, it was flipping sensational games, and it came down to the wire every time.
Mm. You're both quite quirky people, you and Liz. You know that, don't you?
And the thing is, we never gave one another stick on court, though.
Yeah.
Like, her and Kath Harvey would have a yarn, and then me and Bill or me and Dean will have a yarn. But, yeah, no, we never sledged one another.
Yeah.
That would have been horrendous.
She says otherwise. She reckons she was the greatest sledger ever of you.
No. I don't know.
You had selective hearing.
I would have just smiled, and she would have gone so angry. She's like, what is she smiling for? What the hell is she smiling for?
Best way to wind her up. Hey, you and continuing on the you and Liz theme, you ever so kindly agreed to join us in Melbourne for the Centurions. And so that people understand, when we put the Centurions on, it was Sherelle, Kath, and Liz being three of the now five Centurions, but back then four, Vicky Wilson being the other one, and we put this stage show on. And then it went to Melbourne, and Netball Australia were really keen for us to put it on it the night before Fast Five was on. But they said, do you reckon we could get a Kiwi influence? And so I picked the phone up and I rang you and I said, you know, do you want to come and do this stage show with us? And you were like, yeah, what is it? You know, do you remember? We brought you into that show and taught you a two-hour stage show in under 48 hours.
Oh, it's great. Oh, I loved every minute of it. That was so much fun. I was blindsided so many times, but it was so good. I thought it was more entertaining than the people that were sitting there, but no, it was by far the best night ever. It was so much fun. And the funny thing is, you showed all the bloody goals I missed. I was like, how does that work?
Look, if I was a Kiwi hosting a Kiwi Centurions, it'd be the other way around.
You should bring it to New Zealand. People would love that.
Yeah, I'd love to. You should have your own Centurions and there's enough of you to put up on stage. It would be extraordinary. It'd be unreal.
So good.
What I will do for everybody, because when we had you in that show, Eyes, we did a special little introduction of you and Liz. So I'm going to drop that video in at the end of our chat tonight.
Is it our lip syncing one?
Yes, it is. I'm going to pop it in. I think people will enjoy it. Not a lot, unless they went to that show, no one will have ever seen that video. So it'll be a nice little special one. Hey, before I let you go, I've got a couple of quick questions for you. Who was one of your best teammates you played alongside, someone that you just really adored and admired so much?
Laura Langman.
Why?
Because when we played, we were really good friends. But when we were on court, we demanded excellence. If I wasn't available, Laura would chuck the ball down and go, why aren't you available? And same with her, when the defender's on my back and I'm like, give me the ball. And she's like, you're not available. I'm like, you know, like we would literally go hammer and tongs. But what happened on court stayed on court. It never escalated to anything else. And yeah, I think we just pushed one another and made sure that we trained harder than anyone else and trained harder than what the game actually should be.
Can you cook a meal?
I married really well, so my husband is the cook. And yes, I can if I get chucked under the bus, but he is so lovely and he's been doing it for 25 years, so I doubt it's ever going to come down to that.
Don't change. If you you watch a bit of Suncorp Super Netball, so I imagine you know the teams and the plays. If you could be back playing on the court now, which goal attack would you like to have alongside you?
I would still love Nat Methurst.
Mm-hmm.
I know she's pregnant, but yeah, if I ever had the opportunity, or Gretel Tippett, I think she's a freak. Nat Meters in that era, and probably Gretel Tippett now. Yeah.
What's the future for the Silver Ferns?
Oh, it's bright. Man, with Nolene Tauroa here, with the young ones coming through, I think Aussie need to up their game, and they need to choose their coach very wisely, because we are coming for you.
Who's, if you're a selector, who gets the Aussie job?
Oh, it has to be Simone McInnes, doesn't it?
I don't know.
To me, it feels obvious. Or Liz Ellis, actually. She can do anything. Honestly, I think.
Yeah, Lizzie has absolutely said no at the moment because of her family. You know, she said down the track it might be something, even being in a role of some sort. But for the moment, her priority is her young family. So she's a no-go.
Yeah. She's so damn good, though. Yeah.
What about you? What about, not for you as Aussie coach, but feel free if you want to come on over. what's your future in coaching?
At the moment, I'm doing my PC performance coach qualification. So I am on the coaching pathway, but I think I need experience, and I need to, I think for me, it's more, I know the game, but it is getting to that point where you can, when you can marry players together and make them hum within a certain amount of time. So COVID-19 has screwed me a little over this year, but we could potentially still get like half a season underway. So fingers crossed,
yeah,
that would be it. But yeah, no, absolutely love it. And I think because I'm such a people's person, I just love being surrounded by people and, you know, try to get the best out of people.
Yeah, it's a natural trait of yours. I'm not sure if this is going to be a natural trait of yours, but well, I've seen you lip sync, and I know that you don't mind a corona. Have you ever found yourself at a karaoke bar belting a tune out?
No, because I am wise enough to evacuate before anything happens.
Right, okay. But yes. See, the sad state of affairs for you, my friend, right here and right now is that the only way you get to exit Gordy's Gas Bags is with a little karaoke number for me with no music.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Gordy. Happy birthday to you. And that's all you're getting out of me, mate.
Surely you can give me something better than that. Like, I'm happy on March the 24th if you want to sing it to me.
No, I need a lot more than one corona to get me on stage there.
All right, so what we'll do is we'll drop in your lip syncing with Liz Ellis. I think you've given us happy birthday. I will accept that as your challenge, and we'll drop the lip syncing because I think everyone will enjoy that.
Awesome.
Hey, listen, before you go, this is for Kiwi Week. I've been going all week. It's been a hectic week. It's been a fun week. For some reason, there's too many of you to not jam pack into a 7-day period. So I've had to go the full 7. So I've got one night left, and there's still a lot of big names out there, but I've offered every night, each of you to challenge me. So you're going to close Kiwi Week with the final challenge. Who should I go?
Well, I'm glad you've seen the light to come over to the ditch, over the ditch to us. So all kudos to you. I am going to send you to, my challenge to you, Gordy, is go to Italy and talk to Kat Tuiviti.
Oh, my. What about the time difference?
You asked for a challenge, though.
I had to interview Dan Ryan the other night, and I was up until all hours of the night. But anyhow, Kat
Tuiviti. Oh, you're going to finish with a bang.
I know.
God, I can't wait for that.
Oh, if she gives me a look away, I won't know what to do. But anyhow, I can't wait. So, Kat Tuiviti. Right, I'm coming at you, Kat. What's the time? I will give you a call. Let's hope we can try and sort this in a 24-hour period. And that, my friends, would round out Kiwi Week. But tonight, Eyes, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it. I know even amongst COVID, you're exceptionally busy. And everyone wants a piece of you. So I'm glad I got a piece of the cake. Thank you, champion.
Absolutely loved it. Thanks, Gordy.
Thanks, mate. You look after yourself. Take care of you and your family. Ladies and gentlemen, that's Gordy's Gas Bags for Saturday night. Take a look at this video.
Hello, it's me. I was wondering if after all these years you'd like to me to go over everything. They say the time's supposed to heal you, but I ain't done much pain. Hello, can you hear me? I'm in California dreaming about who we used to be when we were younger and free. I've forgotten how it felt before the world fell at our feet. There's such a difference between us and a million miles. I must have told a thousand times.